Thank you, Honorable Brad Corbett, Chancellor of the SIU Carbondale, Honorable Randy Dunn, President of Southern Illinois University System, Honorable Senators and Representatives, and Honorable Mayors, Mr. Jack Ticciaro, Interim Director of the Paul Simon Institute, Ms. Sheila Simon, former Illinois Lieutenant Governor and daughter of the late Senator Paul Simon, and also son, Mr. Martin Simon. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to be with you this morning. Thank you for your warm welcome. This is my last of the last visit anywhere outside of New York. I'm counting my days. I have just 10 days to go. From tomorrow I have to count 10, 9, 8, 7. January 1st, I'll become a private citizen, free man, finally, after 10 years. I'm very happy to have this big and very important gathering, public speech. This is my last of the last public speeches. You may be surprised at how many public speeches, small or big, I have been making during the last 10 years. Thousands of thousands, maybe 3,000-4,000 speeches. Of course, without any on the radio. I have been really enjoying, and it has been great opportunities for me to meet with the people. It's not that Secretary General be always a president, the prime ministers, or ministers. It's very important that I meet the students, professors, mayors, governors, state representatives and senators, and the people, people on the ground, just the citizens. This is a part of my such ongoing efforts, and I'm very much grateful for your taking time to discuss with me, how we can work together, how we can make this world better for all. In many, many aspects, this is what I'm going to say something and discuss with you and listen to your views. Ladies and gentlemen, practically speaking, since I have only 10 days to go, it may be very difficult for you to expect that I come back to this university again. Therefore, let me say just to congratulate in much in advance for a very happy 150th anniversary of a university which you will celebrate in 2019, just 3 years later. And let me also thank you for wonderful gift this SIU has given to me this morning. You have joined just now the United Nations Academic Impact. This is a network of partnership between the United Nations and with so many universities around the world. We need to have a closer partnership and closer support from professors and students of the institutions of higher learning, like University of SIU. And I'm very happy you have joined some group of thousands of universities worldwide, and I hope we'll discuss all the matters of our common concern for humanity. I would also like to congratulate Paul Simon Institute on Public Policy on its 20th anniversary to be marked next year. So everything is in congratulating in advance. I hope you'll keep record. This institute's namesake was a renowned supporter of international education and active U.S. engagement across international agenda. I am very happy that your university is represented and attended by the students from more than 100 countries around the world. This is almost more than half the membership of the United Nations. So you are dummy United Nations, and thank you very much for that. I think you can elect some Secretary General or and I know that Paul Simon, he also has visited more than 100 countries around the world. I have been traveling during the last 10 years more than 150 countries around the world. But I'm just counting however many times, multiple visits I have visited to a country, I'm counting one. Then by that count, I have visited 154. If I count the multiple visits, I have been visiting 560 countries around the world, at least more than 55 countries a year. Then I can tell you, he sounds like my kind of guy. But of course, what is most important is not the number of countries you have visited, but the distance one goes to help people in need for humanity. Senator Simon represents the United States at UN meetings on arms control under two presidents, President Carter and President Reagan. In that same bipartisan spirit, he was the driving force behind two foreign assistance laws that have advanced global cooperation in addressing water challenges. Let me also thank the United Nations Association of Southern Illinois, UNA Southern Illinois. You and your fellow associations across the world are among the United Nations' best allies, linking the global and local, and letting people know that the United Nations works for them, and you are working for the United Nations. So I'm very glad to be in a place where global citizenship is a part of the school's identity, and where diversity is in the campus DNA. Ladies and gentlemen, I am visiting at a time of transition here and there, and a time of uncertainty. Here in the United States, you are preparing to inaugurate a new president January next year. At the United Nations, I will soon return to civilian life, as I told you. There are just 10 days left in my term, my final 10 days. It's the first time that the heads of United Nations and United Nations are changed in the history of 70 years. It's the first time. I don't know when such time will come, because U.S. presidential term is 4 years or 8 years. Second generals, 5 years or 10 years. So it's rare, very difficult to coincide the transition, but this is the first transition in both places. The world is also going a transition in every sense. We are becoming more urban as more people live in cities. We are becoming younger, with the largest generation of youth the world has ever known. Half the population to do something for young. We are striving to make a crucial economic and environmental transition to a safer, more sustainable path of development in order to make peace with the planet and ensure prosperity for people. I have served during the decade of turmoil, the world suffered biggest financial collapse since the Great Depression. Great Depression happened in 1929. After 28 years, the world has suffered from that global financial crisis. That has changed a lot of aspects, dimensions of our world, of course, including the United Nations. There are more refugees and people in need of humanitarian aid today than any time since the end of the Second World War. We have 65 million refugees and displaced persons, internally displaced persons. We have at least 130 million people who need daily life-sustaining support by the United Nations. So we have to provide breakfast, lunch, dinner, and water, sanitation, education, and some place to live. These are what we are facing now. That's why just 2 weeks ago, the United Nations has appealed to the world that we need at least $22 billion to support them next year. And I have asked President Obama last week at the White House and Vice President Joe Biden, we need U.S. strong support to meet this demand. As you know, conflicts are growing more protracted. Political polarization is growing more entrenched. Shocking crimes have been carried out against civilians caught up in armed conflict, defying the rule of war. Even in peacetime, basic human decency often seems in short supply as people look and talk past each other. These challenges have been as numerous and complicated as any we have seen in the United Nations history. We have made important advances, but of course, the work of the United Nations is never finished. And my successor, new Secretary General Antonio Guterres, will face, I think, many, much more urgent demands from day one. As you know, the conflict in Syria is still continuing, and it has defied the efforts of some of the world's most experienced United Nations mediators. I have appointed my predecessor, Kofi Annan, and appointed another very skilled diplomat, Dr. Brahimi, and our third mediator is still struggling, so that we are not able to have any sign of political solution of this crisis. I continue to stress that there is no military solution. There is only inclusive political solution. The military success in Aleppo, Syria, what they claim, they have cleared all these terrorists or extremists in Aleppo. In the name of fighting against extremists and terrorists in Aleppo, they have destroyed the whole, they have killed so many people, they have destroyed all these infrastructures. Now, fortunately, when the United Nations Security Council showing some unity of purpose, just 3 days ago, they have adopted by unanimous consensus a resolution allowed to deploy United Nations monitors so that we make sure that these people, civilians, can be evacuated safely and humanitarian assistance can be delivered. But this is just the small things which we can do at this time. The whole, almost 60-70% of Syria have been destroyed. There is no functioning hospitals or medical clinics, no functioning skills. The water supplies has stopped. This is, I have said a few days ago, the situation in Aleppo is a synonym to hell, which we can see on this earth. It's not only in Syria. We have such big fires are still burning in Yemen, Mali, South Sudan. Tens of thousands of people have become internally displaced and had to flee their home country. We are warning about the risk of genocide again. We have been committing ourselves after 1994 genocide in Rwanda, 1995 genocide in Srebrenica. We committed, never again, never again. I'm afraid to tell you that if the world is not united, and if the parties to the conflict are not united, we may again have to see there's a genocide again. And almost everywhere, people are concerned about the drugs, terrorism, and next extreme storm of outbreak of disease. Yet amid this insecurity, there are gains to report. Over the past 10 years, the United Nations successfully ended peacekeeping operations in Sierra Leone, Timor-Leste. We will soon do the same in Liberia and Cote d'Ivoire. We also helped ensure a peaceful political transition in Burkina Faso and peaceful elections in Guinea, and supported historic transition in Myanmar, democratic transition. But we have much more things to do in those countries too. We have also seen, despite turbulence on many fronts, the world come together to adopt an inspiring new plan for the world's future, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development Goals. The agenda is encapsulated in 17 Sustainable Development Goals. We call it SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, to guide us as we strive to end extreme poverty, hunger, empower women, increase access to quality education, and build effective institutions that serve people. These goals apply to all the countries, including the United States, most well-to-do and richest country in the world. These goals are very ambitious, far-reaching, and if we can implement successfully and fully the 17 goals by 2030, 15, 14 years more, then I can tell you that we can live in a world much healthier, much more prosperous, much more peaceful, where everybody can live with a human dignity. That's the commitment of the United Nations. That is the promise of world leaders, including President Obama. We are nearing the end of the first year of implementing this 15-year-old plan. I have been encouraged to see governments, businesses, and people mobilizing behind the SDGs. This work will bring improvement in the daily lives of people across the world. And this will make sure that this planet Earth will remain environmentally sustainable. So it's for the people, it's for the planet, it's for prosperity. Ladies and gentlemen, I also draw hope from the inroads we are making in combating climate change. December last year, in Paris, the world leaders again gathered. and adopted historic agreement, what is known as Paris Agreement on Climate Change. It has been taking longer than 20 years. The negotiations have been just almost dormant, not moving at all. I've been saying that it's moving like a snake. When I took my job in 2007, I made a firm promise to the world that I will make this number one priority. Of course, there were many priorities when it comes to country, but when it comes to development issues, that was my number one priority. And we made, finally, success. But this success is just the beginning. We promised that, first of all, we have to cut this climate phenomenon. We cut greenhouse gas emissions, thereby making sure that the global temperature rise is contained at 2 degrees Celsius. Or if we strive down to 1.5 degrees Celsius by the end of this century, So it's a kind of 85-year plan. Can we do it? I believe I can do it. We can do it. But if we continue the way as we have been doing now, then this global temperature rise may go up, unfortunately, as high as 3.5 degrees instead of 2 degrees. Then that will be the catastrophic situation for the world. But at the same time, if we do much, much more to make sure that this climate agreement is fully implemented by 197 parties, then I think we can save this planet Earth from falling into a catastrophic situation. We can save human beings. And we can make sure that we hand over this world to our succeeding generations in a sustainable way. This is something which we need to be proud altogether. The President Obama and President Xi Jinping of China, I think they have led this campaign together with the United Nations. Beyond this, I can tell you that I have devoted all my passion, time, and energy to make sure that world leaders move toward the right direction. To make sure that I convince them, if I do not lead by example, I cannot convince. I would not have any convincing power. So I have visited Antarctica 3 times. Do you know how difficult it is to visit Antarctica? I'm not an explorer or something like this. I went to South Arctic and Antarctica, and I have visited all the places in the world, however remote, however dangerous, wherever and whenever. I was able to see the impact of climate change. Not only melting glaciers, which you have seen many times in the TV images, but rampant deforestation, which is still taking place in Amazon River Basin and many other forestry countries. And I have seen the flat salt bed by mismanagement by human beings. The once a big ocean has become just a wide salt bed. It's amazing, very surprising. That's what I have been sounding alarm bells to world leaders. Finally, they agreed. But this is just the beginning. We have a long road, 85 years. We must make sure that whether it comes Republican administration, Democratic administration, whoever is in power. Whoever is in power, not only in the United States, and elsewhere, must make sure that this promise must be kept and fully implemented. This is what the United Nations will continue to make sure that all the leaders agree and implement it. The climate change is very weird. You have seen extreme pattern, weather patterns. The science has made it simply, plainly clear through 5 successive assessment reports by more than 2,000 world's best scientists. They found that this climate change phenomenon has been caused by human behavior. Since Industrial Revolution 200 years ago. So during the last 200 years, and particularly these days, with the rapid growth of industrialization, the people are just emitting all the greenhouse gas emissions toward the atmosphere. Unless we stop this one, unless we use sustainable energy, unless our business communities take a retool and reshape their business operations in a low-carbon economy, decarbonize their industrial operations, we have no hope. But I can tell you now, it's very encouraging that Fortune 500 business CEOs and many thousands of business leaders around the world, they are now changing. They are now trying to use sustainable energy. Much more investment in solar energy, or wind power energy, and hydropower energy. I think these energies are sustainable without creating much greenhouse gas emissions. So let's make sure that our civil society and universities and students, particularly young students, you make sure that you tell your president, you tell your senators and representatives and mayors and governors, then mayors and governors, they should lead by example. The president normally makes the plans, legislations, but it's the mayors and governors. Even in the universities, there are many areas you can make sure that you don't make much greenhouse gas emissions and you use all your sustainable energy. Can you promise?
Answer.
when light patients is light because the purpose of the founding of United Nations was let's get united. So when United Nations is united, it can be much, much stronger, much better to the people. Particularly when Security Council is united, then that's the best answer in maintaining peace and security. And why this similar situation for South Chicago, most recently, have not been able to be resolved. There's a disunity, division among Security Council members, particularly among permanent members of the Security Council who can wield the veto powers. This includes the United States, Russian Federation, and all these discussions have been mostly between United States and Russian Federation. If they can agree, mostly we have seen that something could be done. During the President Obama's administration, Secretary of State John Kerry, and he has been working persistently and continuously with a strong diplomatic push and in discussing this matter. Unfortunately, most of the cases, they have not been able to agree. That's why the Security Council has not been effectively addressing. And can we change the situation? At this time, I'm not able to say anything about it. It's just beyond my control. That's in the hands of former members of the Security Council. You know, broadly, the member states, one of the 93. But most importantly, there is a five veto power countries commission will be very crucially important. I have been urging them, please make sure that the work conduct of the bidders should be more transparent, more accountable, and please lay down the narrow, the national and personal perspectives and interests. Just think about the people. Think about the people we serve. Unfortunately, the member states, in most cases, they bring their personal or very narrow national perspectives. That's why we have not been able to see this one. There have been long time efforts, I think longer than 20 years ago, to make sure that Security Council changed its method of work. But unfortunately, they have not been able to agree on any single reform. That's one thing which I think.
Mr. Secretary, one of the is your own homeland. What are your hopes for trying to normalize relations with North Korea? The two states have been technically at war since the arms system more than 60 years ago. How does this play out now, given the current leadership vacuum in South Korea? And are you going to play any role in trying to bring about some normalization of relations with the North?
This is an academic institution, not political institution. I'd like to answer about the first part of the question. And let us see how I can answer the second part. It's a source of grave concern that tension on the Korean Peninsula between the South and North Korea has been mounting, mainly because of North Korea's continuing provocative actions. First of all, to develop nuclear weapons, they have already developed, but improve their technology improve their technology and improve their ballistic missile capacities. This year only, they have tested 2 nuclear weapons and more than 20 ballistic missile technologies. They have both succeeded in nuclear weapon tests, but the ballistic missile technologies, they have failed most of the time, except for 2-3 times. But failure itself should not be the source of some belief. Each test, whether successful or failure, they are gaining technological knowledge and capacity more and more. It's a source of great concern. I have been urging the members of the United Nations, including the Supreme Council, in consensus, united in this, have been sending unequivocal strong message by imposing sanctions. This 5 sanctions letters by the Supreme Council and plenary team have been sending a strong message. I have been also urging that the North Korea should heed these calls and behave as a responsible member of the international community and mind much more for their own people who are just suffering from poverty. And the economic situation is in shadow in North Korea. But when they use the limited resources, already one of the poorest countries in the world, then they divert all these resources into militarization. Now what do you think it will happen to their own people? It's only the people who are suffering from this. It's not the right for any leader of North Korea. United Nations has been trying to provide the humanitarian assistance, but it's very much limited because of the sanctions. In any way, we will have to do much more. But first of all, diffuse attention through dialogue, by providing some humanitarian assistance to many people who are almost dying. This is something which we can do, but it's very important to maintain a strong stability of the Korean Peninsula. That requires a strong support of U.S. government. Korea and U.S. have a very strong defense alliance system. And this defense alliance has security support and should fully guaranteed and should fully be implemented in the course of many years. On your second part, I have been meeting a lot of people and journalists, and yesterday I told the public that it's quite frustrating to see that the people of South Korea having been gushing out their anger and frustrations at the level of the governments. At the level of the governments. It's not because of the lack of systems, the mechanisms. We have good mechanisms, good democratic institutions. And it's a matter how to use these, how to manage these institutions. At the same time, while this is a very difficult period, I am quite confident that considering that the Korean people have shown a strong sense and commitment to democratic institutions and matured them democratic institutions, and also resilience and wisdom, which they have shown very nicely many, many years in the past. The Korean people have been experiencing many such challenges, but each time they have learned the lessons from them, overcoming with wisdom and resilience, and based on very strong attitude. And I'm confident that we will be able to overcome this. And I told them yesterday that if and when my experience as a second general during the last 10 years is necessary, I will spare no effort to contribute myself to the peace and stability and development of all democratic institutions for my country. But I will have to discuss this matter with the various many leaders of Korean society, and we'll make the final decision.
Thank you.